understanding. So you will be established in understanding. And part of the expectations that I have in my heart concerning you is that your value system will change. What you consider priority will actually change, and that will inform decisions that you make in your life. So pay attention. There is a grace that we are receiving as the word is coming forth. Amen. There is a grace that we are doing what? Receiving. And some of the things that God is depositing in us. Now, I want you to understand that God has given everything that we need for life and godliness. God is not giving anything. It is us that we are receiving more. So. And so I want you to understand that there is a deposit of God that we are receiving today that will serve this generation. So. That will equip you to serve this generation. Like David, he served the purposes of his generation. He was relevant to the purposes of God. Amen? And this is one of those meetings. Grace exchange, grace impartation. And let me just say this. You know, probably after the conference, you know, on Monday, you will not feel as though you are taller or you are... Oh, okay, maybe come on. Umekula sana. Yeah, you will feel you are a bit... Yeah, but... like there won't be change in the physical. Probably wengine mko, most of you mko holiday. Mtarudi kuosha vyombo Monday morning, you know? Jumko holiday na kupika supper. You know? And then you might think that thoughts might start coming like, what happened that weekend, you know? Was there anything that changed in my life really? Because I'm seeing as though things are simply the same. No, things have actually changed in your life. So. Yes. And with the time, the change or the impartation that you have received in this meeting will start to manifest. And as you trace it back, you'll be able to trace it back to this meeting. So. So Father, I thank you that you are good. I thank you for light. Our eyes are open. And our ears are open. Our hearts are open to receive. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, I want us to turn to John 1. And verse 12. So today we'll be going on a journey. So it is important we track together. Okay, actually Somalia happens. Our able IT team. Yeah. John 1 verse 12, it says, but as many as received him, talking about Christ, but more specifically talking about the word light, but it's all Christ. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right. Other versions say power, and other versions say authority. So. Authority. Gave them the authority to become children of God. Will you say, okay, to those who believe in his name. And verse 13. Who are born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. But of God. I want us to read that again. Let's just read it. But as many as received them, to them he gave the right or power or authority to become children of God. To those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Hallelujah. Amen. So one of the things that you have to understand that when you came into Christ, your beginning is from God. You did not start where you were born. So, your birthday is not the time you started existed. You existed before the world was formed. Where did you exist? You existed in the thought of God. Hallelujah. Where did you exist? In the thought of God. And it is from God that you progressed. So I want you to see that when now in Genesis, Adam is referred, or rather in Luke, Adam is referred as the Son of God. Let's just look at that. It should be Luke 3, the last verse, which is 38. It says, in what genealogy, Jesus, he was giving genealogy, Yahweh. And he says, the son of Enosh, who was the son of Seth, who was the son of Adam, who was the son of God. So Adam had his genesis where? In God. Are we together? He had his genesis where? In God. Let's go to Genesis 1. So that we can establish more the, this thought. Where did Adam have his genesis? It was in God. Again, in Genesis 1. Wow. Anyway. I want you to see. Look at, we'll start reading from verse. Okay, let's start from verse 1. And then we're going to skip a few verses. So you're just going to follow with me. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and the darkness was on the face of the deep. Amen. Let's read together from verse 1 again and 2. 1, 2, 3, go. Tell you when to stop.
And God said, let there be light, and there was light.
Mm-hmm.
And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness.
Mm-hmm.
God called the light day, and the darkness he called the night.
Mm-hmm.
So the evening and the morning was the last day.
All right, let's reach there. And when you look at the next verse, it says, God said, let there be a firmament. And then in verse 9, he says, let the waters and the heavens be gathered together into one place. Then verse 10, he called the dry land earth. Yes, up until verse 10. So I want you to see that from verse 1 to around verse 10, that is God creating from nothing. Alright? He created from nothing. Alright? Especially like in verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There was nothing, like up to me, soil or wood to create the heavens and the earth. Like this is part of his quality. So that it shows one of his omnipotent expressions. So he created from nothing. Let's say the raw material he used was his word, and the word is him at the same time. So like that, God created out of nothing. Now I want you to see in verse 11. Now the story begins to change. Verse 11 says, then God says, let the earth bring forth what?
Grass.
The herb that yields seed, etc., etc. And then verse 12, and the earth brought forth grass. Do you see what I'm saying? Verse 13. So the evening and the morning was the third day. So. And then I want you to see another one. We are going to jump again. Look at verse 20. He says, then God said, let the waters abound with an abundance of living creatures. So God spoke to the waters, and the living creatures of the waters came from where? Came from where? Came from the waters. So. And then now let us look again. Verse 21. So God created the sea creatures and every living thing that moves, and with which the waters abounded according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind, and God saw that it was good. Yeah. And then look at verse 24 again. It says, then God says, let the earth do what again? Bring forth what? So I want you to see that these other creations, that there was something, of course it was God who was creating. So. Ultimately, it is God who creates. So. But I want you to see that he used something that he had already previously created, and he called out those things that were in that thing. So. Like the waters in themselves had every living creature that exists in water. So. They were already inside there. But until the word of God came, they would have remained there. But the word of God is what made manifest. So. It's what actually made it to appear. Are you seeing what I'm saying? The cattle and the grass came from the earth. Inside the you know what? Inside the soil were all these animals and all these trees and all this vegetation. But unless the word of God would come, they would have remained there. So the word, in a sense, activated what was already inside that which God created. Hello. So. In case you're wondering, I am explaining how we are born of God. So. We haven't lost track. So, just stay there. So, I want you to see something that is also important. That from the place where the living creature was removed from or created from, that is the place where it is to be sustained. Hello? Fish cannot exist outside water. They will die. No matter how strong fish is, shark, ukileta hapa, like even a rat is more strong than a shark, because the shark is not in its area of domain, but in the water it's a whole different story. No matter how much the tiger is aggressive, in the water it is subject to the shark, and it cannot survive in the water. Can only take a swim, and then it okay. But it cannot have its livelihood where? In the water. Hello? So. So I want you to see that God created the living creatures of the water in the water to be sustained in the water, by the water. So. Are we together there? So he created the living creatures of the water in the water. And they existed where? In the water. Are we together? And so yesterday I was sharing with my group, there is something in CRE they call first account of creation. Okay. And then we had a second account.
That's just talking lot on something. So yeah, the exam just like that. That's all. But I want us to look at this first account. So Genesis 1, now verse 26. Let us look at our Genesis. Then God says, let us make man in our image and according to our likeness. Now, many people think that, you know, the previous thought that I had about this scripture is that, you know, God looks like me physically. You know, I am created in the image and the likeness of God. So I look like God. And I had many preachers say, tell your neighbor that you look like God. You know, I've seen you, I've seen God. Tell your other neighbor, I have seen you, I have seen God. You know, yeah, so tell your neighbor, yeah, you have seen God. Okay, so it seems that I'm trying to tell myself. So we are created. So for me, the mentality I had, how is it that I look like God? So for me, I came to a certain funny conclusion, you know? And then that's how you know, and then without Christ, there's no light. So the conclusion I came into was, you know, if we are about 8 billion people. So if these 8 billion people were to take a selfie simultaneously, you know, and just combine that face into one image, that would be the image of God. And I was serious about my conviction. Hello. Yeah. Amen. But I came to see that is not the case. That's not the case. So, what does it mean to be created in the image and likeness of God? If you look at John 4 verse 24, it says that God is spirit. And those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. But I want you to see that the nature of God is that he is a spirit. He is spirit. And so, when we are being created in the image and likeness of God, so, it is, man is spirit. Man is spirit. And that is what is in the image and likeness of God. And I want you to see, I say, when God wanted to create the waters, I mean the creatures of the waters, he spoke to the waters. And out of the waters came the living creatures of the waters that live in the water and are sustained in the water. So. Now I want you to see, when God was making man, something that he said, look at what he says in verse 26. He says, then God said, let us make man in our image. So when God was creating man, he spoke to himself. Hello? He spoke to himself. Man was already inside of God, and him, by the word, made him manifest. Now God, I mean man, was created in God, and existed in God, and is to be sustained in God. Outside God, there is no life. Hello? Are we together? So outside God, there is no life. You cannot exist. The same way that a fish would die outside the water, man would die if he was separated from God. So. Now this is now what is called the first account. Man already existed. Oh, let's finish this scripture. Then God blessed. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him.
Male and female, he created them. Man is male and female. Man is not a question of gender. Male and female, he created them. This is why when we read in the New Testament, when Paul says, in Christ, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male or female. Because our spirit is in the likeness of God. And God is neither male or female. Just because we use the pronoun he, his, him, does not mean God is a man. God is male. Doesn't mean God is male. Just because we say God is the Father. Father is neither male or female. But for our understanding here on earth, we attribute that to the male gender. But I want you to see that God is neither male or female. In actual sense, the pronouns that are used, especially in the Old Testament, because it was originally written in Hebrew, that pronoun that is used to actually represent God was neither he or she. It was just one that was reserved only for referring to God. And so, when the writers were translating to Greek, in Greek, the New Testament was written in Greek. The Greek language does not have this pronoun that Hebrew has. And because at that time, the society was very patriarchal, so that they would translate that pronoun that refers to God as he. But I want you to see that man is neither male or female. He is spirit, and he was created in God from God, and he existed, he is sustained in God. So, I want you to see that. And so what happens in what is called the second account of creation? It is now the man that is already inside of God is created for a body. And so when God breathes life into the nostrils of that suit, man was already inside of God. So it was God breathing out man. So your genesis did not start when you were manifested on the earth. You began in God. You started in God. Hello? You started where? In God. You started where? In God. So, let's go back now to John. Chapter 1. And so I want you to understand that your life is more than the physical body. So, your life did not start in the year, not in this year, 2002. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory. So your life did not start there. To Papa Mother, when you will leave that body will be buried here, and today is a house. This is simply what is, I've had people call it the earth suit. You know, it says when you go to space, you wear a space suit. When you go for swimming, what do you wear?
Swimsuit.
Yeah, I like my people. Swimsuit. Amen. No, not costume. No. Costume is for festivals. Hallelujah. Anyway. And so when you are coming on earth, when God was like looking to manifest you here, because he gave you dominion over the earth, as God rules in heaven, yours was to rule on earth. So for you to exercise dominion here, there has to be a body prepared for you. And so he created get that body which you are in. And this, the sad reality is so many people focus on that, you know, and like, you know, the outward man is perishing day by day. Amen? Okay, we will walk in divine health. Amen? But this body will still fall. Will still fall. And the Bible says, we shall put on, we shall be given a new body. Hallelujah. That does not age. And everyone will be looking good. You will not have any insecurities. Worry, situation. You know, sir. You know, I was listening to another preacher. I'll say this and move very fast, you know. And this preacher was saying, you know, he was talking to some ladies. And he was saying, you know, some ladies are concerned about their back fat, you know. Very fat, yummy. How does it look? And so this preacher was saying, there is no man in the world who is sitting chatting with his friend. Hey, me chiki bene yo dem akuna back fat. And he was saying, if a man is looking at your back, he's looking at something lower. Anyway, moving very fast. Yeah, let's get back to the spirit. But this body will do what? Will fall. And we will receive a new one. Now I want you to see, let's go back to John chapter 1. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Like, listen, it was not your parents that decided your entry into this earth. That should give you a certain rest. Even though, maybe your parents were tricky kidogo, you know, and you happen to be, you know, according to them, you know, quote unquote, by mistake, you know, it just happened, you know, and so now we have to take care of this. Listen, they might have not planned for you, but God had orchestrated that you be manifested at this time and in this season. Because there is no life that comes outside God. There is no life that will penetrate to heaven without the knowledge of God. Hey, too many years. And so you appear just like that. No, we came from God. God is our Genesis. So. And there is something now. When Adam sinned, he died. So. The Bible says, what does it say? In Romans chapter 3. Let's just go there. It's Romans 5, the one that I'm looking for. And verse 17 all the way to 19. Actually, it's even verse 17. For by one man's offense, death reigned through the one, much more those who receive. Not the first part. For by one man's offense, death reigned. Are we together? So, like through the offense of Adam, death reigned. And death is simply the absence of life. Death is not substance in itself. Darkness is not substance in itself. The reason why we have darkness is because there is absence of light. That's why you cannot measure the there's no measure for darkness. Sasa. Yeah. Like light is the substance. Life is the substance. So the absence of life and the absence of light is death and darkness, respectively. So we were alienated from the life of God. And so, in a sense, we died.
Not actually in a sense, we actually died. Because we left our place of sustenance. Remember, hello? Remember what we shared. You see, the living creatures in the water are sustained where? In the water. But when man died, he was alienated from the life of God. And therefore, if you are alienated from the life of God, the result of that is what is called death. And so, even though you are living, you are simply living dead. Wow. You are simply doing what? Living dead. I'll say this in passing. The problem is, like, people think all life is the same. No, all life is not the same. All life is not the same. Hallelujah. Amen. All life is not the same. The life that is in plants is not the same life that is in animals. And this life in animals is not the same life that is in human beings. And I've said this many times. That's why we don't go for funerals, for chickens. Yeah, we don't go for, like, when chickens die, it is party after. It is you who are saying it. Sasa. But I want you to see, we don't go for funerals for goats. Because the quality of life that is existent inside of them is a lower kind of life than the life that is carried by human beings. But listen, you are not even a human being, because there are higher kinds of life. Above the human kind of life is another life that is called the angelic kind of life. In the Bible, we see angels and we see demons. So these are also living creatures. So, but they have a higher quality of life. This is why they can just enter your room without opening the door. Hello? So. Yeah. Anyway. But even the angelic kind of life is not the highest kind of life. There is a higher kind of life that is called Zoe. This is the life that God has inside of him. And in this life is what God was speaking to, Sasa, when he formed man. So when man was formed inside of God, he had the Zoe kind of life already. Amen. And so when man died, he became human. So the human kind of life is a dead life. That is not living. It is a dead life. So. And this is what God came to restore to us. When he says, whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but will have what? Everlasting Zoe. Everlasting life. The highest form of life. Are we together up until then? The highest kind of life. Man, me, personally, I am determined to see the extent of this life operating on this planet. Yeah? And so I want you to see that you are not, you know, you have never said this, you know, but you are not a human being. It was something that Sharon shared yesterday. Don't you know ye are gods? Let's go to that scripture. Psalms 82. Let me ask you a good question. Are you a child of God? So, I need to ensure. It's to me an evil to do a private living Sunday school. Are you a child of God?
Yes.
They shout, yes! Now I want you to see Psalms 82 and verse 6. It says, I say, you are gods, but that does not end there. Comma, and all of you are children of the Most High. So if you are a child of God, what does that make you? This is where people want to take stones and stone Jesus. Because you know, this is what you are saying. When you are saying, you know, I am the Son of God. You have to recognize what you are saying when you say, I am a son of God. When you say, I am a son of God. What you are saying, that the DNA that is in the Father is the same DNA that is at work inside of you. The life that is in the Father is the life that is at work inside of you. Are you seeing what I'm saying? Are you seeing what I'm saying? So ye are gods, children of the Most High. So, and now, so that you don't get some funny thoughts, when you say ye are gods, it doesn't mean now we start worshipping you. You know, this is the thing that, what are these people saying? What are these people saying? It's because when we say ye are gods, we are not saying that you are deity. So, we are not saying that you are omnipotent. Self-existing one. You are not that one. But you are of his class. You are not taught this in biology. In biology, you are taught there is a class called amphibians. There is a class called mammals. And that is where human beings lie. But we have already established that we are not human beings. There is another class that is called the God class. And that was not studied in biology. So the study of biology is simply about this body that we are living here. That will die in a few minutes. Okay. You know. One day to God is 1,000 years. Yeah, do the math now. But this body will just fall. And this is where, like, listen, if this body, people are still doing, like, I'm dying for a mutation, leave alone this evolution theory. That's why it's called evolution. Theory. It's not even proved. It doesn't exist. It's also a belief. You know, it's simply a conviction. So, but I want you to understand that there has not been any mutation of the human body from the time of Adam. Yani, every human being has the same number of bones, you know, same number of blood vessels. You know what I'm saying? So, you have the same parts in terms of lungs, intestines, colon, you have the same makeup as every other human being that has walked this planet. But up until today, we are still doing researches on this body. If this body is yet to be fully explored, and imagine, this is the suit that God gave you to come in. It is this complicated, Yanni. The suit, even when I read, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7, when it says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels, you know? The earthen vessels is talking about our flesh. So, you might think that and say, you know, this body has nothing to it. But when you look at the complications that God has, the details in this mere earthly suit, in this mere earthen vessel, it shows the excellency of God. How much more what is inside the suit? Yeah. Hallelujah!
Amen!
Amen. Boy,
Yeah, that was fast. Amen.
Amen.
So. Yeah. How much more what is inside?
Amen.
Surely what is inside us, our suit, is of more value than the suit. Yeah. Like no matter how much you buy an expensive attire, suit, three-piece suit, and you make a bow tie, watch, again, expensive, you, the one that you are wearing those things, are of more value than that which you are wearing.
Amen.
So if you, what is inside of you is of much greater value than your suit. So.
You are born of God.
Amen.
Say that. I am born of God.
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 And so now I want you to see something else in that scripture. And then we're going to move on to the other thing that I want to communicate. This was setting up for something. John chapter 1 verse 12. But as many as received him, to them he gave them the right, authority, power to become children of God. Now listen, many people have not tapped into the understanding of their authority in Christ. Many people have not tapped into the understanding of what it means to operate in original design. So, I want you to understand that you being born of God gave you some certain privileges. So, gave you some certain privileges. Are we together?
Yes.
Now, I want us to turn to Romans. Or let's go to Ephesians first. And then we're going to come back to Romans. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 15. Now, even before I continue, just that we're going to read. Ephesians chapter 1. I want you to understand. Now, when God was, the reason why Christ came, the reason why he came was to return man to his original design that he had departed from. So, I want you to see, like, man came from God, and there was a design that he had in God. So, but when he left, or when he was alienated from the life of God, he stopped living in design. So in God looking to reinstate the original design, so, he sent us Jesus, who became the first Christ. Now Christ is not the last name of Jesus. In case you are wondering, we are going to come to this Ephesians. I really want us to read there, but look at Matthew chapter 1. Or let's look at the screen. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21. Matthew 21 verse 21. Now, and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name?
Jesus.
Jesus Christ. You shall call his name Jesus. Story may share. Why? For he shall save the people from their sins. Jesus is his name. You know, in the olden days, the way they used to name people was they would either attach your name to a place or your father. So. That's why when Jesus was calling Simon, he said, Simon, son of John, so. And then we had the other Simon of Cyrene. So, Cyrene is a place. You see, James and John, sons of Zebedee. So, that was like their last name. Where you are swept, so of this. And even like that culture is still with us. Even like if you look
at the name like Arab, for example, actually means son of. So you say Daniel Arab Moy, you know, Arab means son of. Maybe Badis can explain to us in detail some of this. So see her later. So that is what it actually means. So son of, they used to attach you to that. But when they could not trace your father, they would just attach your name to a place. So even Jesus, because we are not sure if Joseph was the father, you know? Yeah? Well, there are multiple speculations happen. So they decided Jesus of Nazareth. So that is how he was recognized as. So Christ is not his last name. Christ is the original design that he came to bring. Christ is the design that was born of God. I want you to see where the origin of Christ. Christ means that it means the anointing or the anointed one. That's what Christ actually means. The anointing, or it means the anointed one. So when we say Jesus Christ, we're saying Jesus the anointed one. Jesus the anointed one. Hey, Yamashadia. Go. Glory to God. Are you ready?
Yes.
When we are saying, hey, Father, what are you doing here? Like, listen, Christ is the design that existed in God. Christ means the anointing or the anointed one. Listen, you don't anoint yourself. And Jesus was not the Christ from the very beginning. There is a time that he became the Christ. And he announced it. We look at it. Look at Luke 4. This is going to be really good. Look at Luke chapter 4. Hey, thank you, Jesus. You know, Jesus went to the wilderness. This is in Luke chapter 4. And just interesting. Let me just read verse 1 just to give you food for thought to think about. Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by whom? The devil. Or the spirit?
The spirit.
Where?
Food for thought. It was the spirit that led him to the wilderness. Now when he came back from the wilderness, look at verse 16.
So he came to Nazareth. This is after he is now back. He is back from the wilderness. Hey, celebrate, you know, the wilderness experiences. Hey, you will know that they have come back. Hey, my friend. So this guy is now back. And he's back with an agenda. And look at his agenda. Verse 16. So he came to Nazareth, his hometown. We have to go back to where we started. Because we have a serious announcement that we are about to make. This one we have to start at home. This is why when we preach, start from Jerusalem, then to there, then to the ends of the earth. So you have to go back home to Nazareth to make a special announcement where he had been brought up. Interesting to note. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. Most important day on the week. And he stood up to read. he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he opened the book, he found the place where it was written. This man had an agenda. Imagine. And then he had a synagogue, a Jonekana synagogue for 40 days in how many weeks? Seven. See, 7 times 7 is 39.
Five weeks.
Excuse me. More than 5 or 6 weeks there about. So yeah, at Jonekana synagogue, those many weeks, and then he shows up, you know, and he stands up to read. And he wastes no time. Bring me the scroll. Isaiah. And then he opens the scroll. And he says, now verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. Because he has christened me.
God.
talking about big album. Now let's go back to Ephesians.
When the Holy Spirit comes on a man, that man becomes Christ. That man becomes born of God. That man becomes born into the original design.
Let's start from verse 11.
In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. And now verse 13. In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So when you got born again, there is the indwelling Holy Spirit that you received. So. And that is what makes you Christ. Being baptized in the Holy Spirit is a different experience. So. Which maybe, depending, we don't know if we'll get the opportunity to speak about it, but what happened to the two ladies here yesterday was that. So. But everyone who is born again, because like you are born, let's look at John chapter 3. Look at John chapter 3. He says that verse 3. Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And then Nicodemus asked, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? And so Jesus understands his predicament. Mic test.
Okay, so, yeah.
Now, Jesus understands the fireworks in his mind. You know, because the complication that is in his mind. Because imagine if somebody, now we understand what being born again means. But imagine you are Nicodemus. This word born again has never been heard anywhere in the scriptures. And you know, Nicodemus is a Pharisee. He has studied the scriptures and he has not seen this. It's a foreign concept. So when Jesus is asked, how can a man? You see, this is something. Look at verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, and he had a question. Verse 2. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God. No one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. You see, Nicodemus is seeing a certain design that is functional, that is not functional in him. Even him, he knows that somehow I am a teacher come from God because he's a Pharisee. But no, why don't I have the same signs as this teacher, as this rabbi that I am seeing here? There must be a disconnect. And he starts having question marks. There is a certain experience that you have that I don't have, and I believe I am a teacher come from God. The same way you are a teacher come from God. And so Jesus understands that this person is asking about design. In many words, maybe he did not know that was the question he was asking. But in other words, he's asking, how can I operate in design? Yeah. Mm. Because if we are saying that we are from God, we should be seeing something.
Amen. Yeah.
commitment should carry a certain level of weight. That we come from God. So, I am a teacher, come from God, lakini mimi wangu tu ni kumwagilia watu sijui nini. There is no actual reality that is from God. But with you, I see the seeker here. With you, I see dead people are raised. And the Pharisees, like, you know, I prayed about being raised from the dead, from Elisha and Elijah, you know. And these people were truly prophets that were from God. So if I am from God, I should be expecting a certain level of results. And I'm not seeing it. And so Jesus understands his question and he gives him an answer. He says, you must be born again. And so he wonders, what do you mean? You know, what do you mean? And so he goes on further to explain verse 3. He explains verse 3 in verse 5. What does it mean to be born again? In fact, the better word that is being born from above. Born from above. That is why we say we are heaven born. Sasa, that's why we are saying heaven is not a place where you are going. It's a place where you are coming from to manifest on earth. It is a place where you are seated and a place where you are manifesting from. When you die, you will not go to heaven. Why? Because you're already there. Why are you waiting to go somewhere you already are? Now look at Jesus' explanation of what it means to be born again. So he explains in verse 5, Jesus answered, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of the water and of the Spirit, I want you to see, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. As we read the scriptures, we won't prove all these things now because of time. But the Bible says you can relate water with the word of God. So. Cleanse them by the washing of the water of the word. Maybe you can find that scripture for us later. It's somewhere in Ephesians 5. Cleansing by the washing of the water of the word. So when we say the word, I mean when we see water, you can symbolize it with the word of God. So unless you are born of the word and of the Spirit, unless you are born of the word and of the Spirit, that is the experience of being born again. So I want you to see, you are born from the word. And you are born of the Spirit. And you are born from God. You are born of God. So yani, with all that means, you are born from the word. You are born from the Spirit. You are born from, you are born of God. That is the origin of Christ. When you say born of God, it should carry something. What I was trying to say, when you get born again, the Holy Spirit had to come inside of you. And so when the Holy Spirit came upon you, you ceased to be a human being. You died. And you no longer live. But who lives in you? Christ. But we are seeing that in Ephesians 1:13, we are saying that we have the indwelling Holy Spirit inside of us. So it is to say that when the Holy Spirit comes on a man, that is when he becomes Christ. It's just to further prove what I'm trying to communicate. But are you seeing what I'm saying? Now, being born of God introduces us to a certain reality that Nicodemus noticed. So, that this is the original design. And so, I'm about to conclude. This is what I was driving to with all this talk. Talk of life, amen.
Amen.
Now let's go to Ephesians again, now 1 verse 15. And we start from there. And it says, therefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Why? That the eyes of your understanding be enlightened. Why? That you may know three things. The first one, that you may know what is the hope of his calling. And number two, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. And number three, what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age but also that which is to come. Very long sentence, but those are three things. To know the hope of the calling, to know the riches that are in the saints. Notice what it says. Riches. That should be verse 18. Look at what it says, verse 18. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. The inheritance is in the saints. It's not somewhere out there. Because listen, the full investment of God was in Christ. Haven't you seen that Christ, the origin from of Christ, born of the Word, born of the Spirit, born of God. This is why the fullness of the Godhead dwells in him bodily. Yeah. Colossians chapter 1. The fullness of God dwells. So when you received Christ, hallelujah.
Amen.
You received the fullness of God. God invested everything in Christ. So I'd like to let you know that this reality we are calling you into, it is worth leaving everything else. Because once you get Christ, you get everything else. Christ is the key that unlocks creation. So, like, listen. That's why. When you were listening to, like, Sharon, you know, she was really saying, you know, and even Liz, and he mentioned these things, you know, that it's not about exams and meaning, you know, and they would talk with so much vigor and man. How do you stay here after a conference? You know, we just feel like, yes, I always say to my resignation letter for Shule, you just feel like, you know, we can leave this thing, the potato Bible, give me Jesus, you can have this whole world. You feel like that, and the reason is because when you understand the wealth that is in Christ, these other things, they lose taste. The reason why you would feel your toes are being stepped on, you feel your heart some type of way, it is because you think that in this system there is something that can be offered. But I mean, the human kind of life is a dead life. So any system that originated from human beings is a dead system. And there was something I said some time back in the year with the two guys. I asked them a question: is education life? And it was just a debate. And I've never seen people so divided, you know? Hey, I just allowed them, I stayed back for like 5 minutes. I saw even people that seemed friends when they entered, they disputed. Education is not life, education is life, you know, you need it. And it was an interesting conversation that I had. And you know, I had views from different sides of the camp. You know, they are saying education is not life. Like, Jesus is life, but when you ask them why, they really don't know. But it is where you're on the right track. You're on the right track. And I pray that we will have understanding so that we are able to understand the Jesus. But they're still on the right track. And then so when I asked this other side, they also are vehemently for education is life. And they had some solid points, you know. How do you want to engage that from this side? They are saying, I think I can consider coming like this. And many a times you feel like that. At times you feel that the original design, we are going to talk about it in a few. That's what I was coming to. But the design is not manifesting. So you don't have a say. You don't, it's like you don't have a voice. But these people, they have seen what it avails. So somehow they have a voice and they can somehow convince you that there is something here. But I want you to know that any system that originated from human beings is a dead system. So when I ask them, is education life? So they were all waiting for my answer. They are not on the TV. And the other one said, wow, Father, give us utterance to say this thing correctly, you know? And I'll say, education is not life. And then I say, comma. We have not finished the statement. Education is not life. Education needs life. There is no life that can be offered to you by any human institution. Yeah. We are the carriers of life. The Bible says, as the Father has life in himself, he has granted the Son to have life in himself, and he has given him authority to execute judgment. And the judgment of God is life. So we have been given authority to make life happen on the earth. This is why creation is awaiting the manifestation of the sons. Because they also desire to be partakers of the life of God, the same way that we have been partakers of the life of God. So education is not life. Education needs life. So are we saying that you leave the system? No. We are saying, don't be like, no. We are saying your sustenance, your origin is not the system. The system is also crying out for life. So you have a different goal. When you enter the university of choice, if it is Harvard, you recognize, I'm the one that is making Harvard shine. It is because, you know, when we go to Oxford and this thing, it is because we have had the cry of creation there. They have groaned for sons. Please come. Hey, so you come. And you say, yes, I'm here. Oxford, you're here. Oxford, I'm here. Not begging the system. Said that my school is blessed because I'm here. Amen. Yeah, when somebody asks you, you know, she you na pangaje. I na pangasi ano eh. No. Tell them the school is wonderful, perfect, and then they wonder, hey, how are you speaking with such enthusiasm? Why is it like that? Because I'm here. Hallelujah. Amen. So I want you to see. Now. I want you to see the place of the Holy Spirit in living out Christ. That's the thing I really want you to see. That's why it's my emphasis. So. Yeah. Christ originated from God, Word, and the Spirit. So. Even the Word was made flesh. And he dwelt among us. So. So Christ is also the Word. It's also the Spirit. Also, it's all three in one. Hallelujah. It's called Trinity. Fullness of God dwells there. But I want you to see now Romans 1. We are concluding. Even the others are real. Isn't there? Yeah. Paul said finally twice. So we follow the example of the Word. imagine you're in the chat and Andika finally twice, you know? So imagine Andika, okay? This is why I did to teach 6 hours. I didn't see him a day. Yeah. Because of death, the Word was too much, you know? Yani, the flesh died. Became spirit. That's my man that experienced the spirit. And Paul, and our mutual father, you have to manifest Christ here. So, don't die on me. But you already died, so. Now look at Romans chapter 1, verse 16. It says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ." There is a reason why he's saying I'm not ashamed. And he has to help you understand why is he not ashamed. And he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also the Greek. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 24. But maybe we can start from verse 22. For Jews seek, request a sign, and Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. Like, listen, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. They will not understand why you would convene to such a meeting for 4 days. But as we understand, we are here to receive an understanding of Christ. So to the Jews it is a stumbling block. To the Greeks, it's foolishness. That's why you hear statements like utakula iman, you know? Because to them, anyway. Actually, must remain. Otherwise, I'll jump a little. So verse 24. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. So he says, I am not ashamed of the power of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And here we see that Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. So I want you to see that Christ is the power of God. But in the same breath, look at Acts 1 verse 8. It says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So I want you to see, these are complementary scriptures. They are not contradicting scriptures. It says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, which is the power. But in this place we are seeing that he said, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you shall receive power. How is it so? I want you to see, the ministry of the Holy Spirit is in John, let's look at John 14.
Is it John 14 or 16? The ones who know where I'm going. 16 verse 13.
However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come.
So how does that relate to the power?
The power of God is experienced in the revelation of Christ. And so it says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Now, the purpose of the Holy Spirit is not for you to fall down, shake, roll, and scream. It's not bad to do those things. Hallelujah. You know? You can do you're free to do as the within the limits of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, let's just be clear.
Okay.
So the purpose of the Holy Spirit, how you get to experience design that you already have. The design is already present in Christ, and you receive Christ when the Holy Spirit indwelt you. Are we together? But as the Holy Spirit comes upon you, the power, the way the power is experienced is how you receive revelation concerning the gospel of Christ. That is what produces power. Maybe I should use an example. Look at Acts chapter 2, so that you can see. After the Holy Spirit came upon them. So, verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. So that is where the Holy Spirit came upon them. But I want you to see what it produced. Peter, who was timid, stood up to speak. He was bold all of a sudden. But I want you to understand where the boldness came from. There are even results. Like, it says, verse 40, after the end of the sermon, and with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received the word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. Imagine. Preaching without microphone and in one meeting, 3,000 are saved. Man, this guy was bold. The guy who was denying Jesus the other time, he manifested in boldness. He manifested in boldness, and he actually was relevant to the purposes of God at that particular time. Why? It is because he received a revelation. If we read closely in we start from verse 14 at the beginning of his sermon. He says, but Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judea, all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. For we are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day, you know? But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. This was what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Listen, like that book of Joel was there ever since, before Peter was born. But when the Holy Spirit came upon them, he got a revelation of the scripture. He got a revelation of the word that this is what was spoken of by Joel, and what was that was spoken of. And it shall come to pass that in the last days, says the Lord, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall see dreams, and it goes on and on. But I want you to see, as he got a revelation, that is where the power flowed. The power was not really in the laying on of hands. You can lay hands on people until the top of their head, the top of their hair rubs off, yeah? Bring out the anointing oil. Slap people around. Step on them, yeah? Kicking the devil out. But if you have no knowledge, you have no power. If you have no knowledge, you cannot experience the design of Christ. And this is the place of the Holy Spirit in living out Christ. His work is to give you a revelation, an understanding. This is what Paul prays. I pray that the spirit of wisdom and revelation, that your eyes may be enlightened, so that you may understand the power that is at work within you, the same power that raised Christ from the dead. Talking about Jesus. So the place of the Holy Spirit is to guide us into all truth, to open our eyes. And this is why this is our life's practice. And seeking the excellence in the knowledge of Christ. That's what Paul says. All these other things. This is where we are closing up. Philippians 3. He says, but the things that were gained to me, but what things were gained to me? These I have counted loss for Christ. This is verse 7. 3 verse 7. And he says, yet indeed I count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ. You see, for him, he was not after the expression of Christ, because that is a byproduct of knowledge in Christ. We don't seek Christ so that you pass in your exams. We don't seek Christ so that you will be healed. Christ is bigger than your disease. Christ existed before your disease. So his purpose cannot to be to solve something that came after it. Are you seeing what I'm saying? So Christ, what are we saying? Like as we pursue Christ, we are not chasing the outward expression as Nicodemus. But that will come as a byproduct of you pursuing the knowledge of Christ. I want you to notice, like Paul was counting these things as a loss for something. He was counting, verse 8, yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as hashtag down. That I may gain Christ. And say, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. And verse 10, look, that I may know him, that I may know him. This is eternal life, to know him. Sasa, excellence in the knowledge of Christ. Are we together? That I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of the sufferings, being conformed to his death. And then verse 11, if by any means I may attain In other words, what he's saying there, he's saying, I pray that I will come into the full expression of the resurrected state that I have been raised to. Are you getting what I'm saying? Yeah. He's saying, if by any means I may attain to the, you know, it is the same Paul that says, we know in part, but then we shall know everything as we are fully known. Imagine if this is Paul who is saying we know in part. Truly, we know in part. And so, like, I want you to understand, because of the restriction of the flesh, like, there will always be there will always be more to the experience and the expression of Christ. And so he's saying, I have left everything. I have counted all things as loss. Why? So that I can gain this thing that is of value. So that I can gain an excellence. I just don't want to know Christ. Christ, mono in Christian, I believe in Christ, you know. Hey, he died on the cross. You have no understanding left, right, and center. You know, this is why you are Christian, to go to heaven and to give such shallow answers. No understanding of Christ, not established. So for him, he said, I want to gain an excellence. You see, the reason why people think Christ is foolishness is because they don't think that there is a depth to Christ. They think Christ is simply surface. They think Christianity is John 3:16. End of story. They only think that. And so for them, they think, I see Sunday 2 hours in Metosha. And yet, as we are looking even for time, and we are squeezing in schedules so that we can just come into this excellence of the knowledge of Christ. In Matatus, we are listening to sounds. When we are walking, we are speaking in tongues. Because this is how we live. We are reading the word, we are speaking in tongues so that the Holy Spirit can reveal. After he has revealed, that is where the power comes from. That is where the experience is, in the revelation. In the revelation. That's why you must have a walk with the Holy Spirit to live Christ. Because he has Christ in you. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you. And it is him who has Christ in you. He's the one who made that word come alive in you. Glory to God. So you see, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. Man, this is my life's pursuit. I want to know. You know, like the question, like, well, and then I'm finishing. Yeah. It is finished. Then it's a my boy that's from your act together.
Wow.
So listen, you must have a walk with the Holy Spirit to live Christ. The question is never, what will Jesus do? I think we're gonna raise bands, make a sticker for Gary, WWJD.
What did Jesus do?
You're listening to some other person and they say that James was the brother of Jesus. And so after Jesus a little, what time to why? So in the next party, Jesus was not there. It was James Pekea, you know. So guys are looking at him, you know. So when I get the brother for the party. And so this guy was asking, what would James do? Yami, JD, everything. Such a tricky situation. Anyway, the question is never, what would Jesus do? So, because I want you to see, the ministry of Jesus on earth, you cannot understand your new man by looking at Jesus. I'm sorry, but tutasema, You cannot understand the new man by looking at Jesus. Jesus says, I did not come to bear witness of myself. For you to understand the Father, you look at Jesus. This is why Jesus never mentions the word grace. It is in the term, it is, okay, if you read John chapter 1, he said, it is John who is saying that he came full of grace and truth. But Jesus verbatim, he did not talk about grace. And these are some of the fundamental things in the faith. He did not teach about grace verbatim, like anakalisha watu chini. What he talked about was kingdom of the Father. So he came to bear witness of the Father because the Old Testament had massacred the character of the Father. So you cannot understand the Father by reading the Old Testament alone. You cannot. You will see he's killing some people here, stealing life somewhere there. He's Sodom, Gomorrah, something. Then you wonder, why don't you say about it? But Jesus came to say, He is come from God. No one has seen the Father at any given point, but the Son bears witness of him. So the ministry of Jesus was to bear witness to the Father. Hey. But there was another witness. When the Spirit comes, he will testify of me. This is what Jesus was saying. He was saying, I have other things to tell you, but you cannot bear them now. You do not have the internal framework to understand how I am operating here. You do not have. So, you just wait. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, he will guide you into all truth. So, for you to understand the new man, for you to understand how Jesus was operating, you have to look to the Holy Spirit. And this is why when you read some of the epistles by Paul and Peter and James, Hebrews and all that, you know, you hear things that Jesus did not say verbatim. How did they get such understanding? From the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit now bears witness of the Son. So,
yes.
And even in the ministry of Jesus, there were acts of grace, you know, but he did not teach it. Like, in his lifestyle, there was, you know, like the woman caught in adultery. That is grace at work. But he did not sit down and teach people grace. But these people, they had a revelation. This is why you must walk with the Holy Spirit. He's the only one who can reveal to you the new man created in Christ Jesus after the likeness of him. So. And so, this is our lifestyle. And this is my prayer for you. And that out of this place, this will be your single pursuit. Pursuing excellence in the knowledge of Christ. End of story. That is my life. What is your profession? Pursuing excellence in the knowledge of Christ. And as you pursue him, when we receive the knowledge, we will receive power, definitely. It's a byproduct. And the expression will be effortless. The reason why people struggle with you know, keeping some self-made rules and regulations is because of a lack of a revelation of Christ. When you receive a revelation of who you are, the expression comes effortless. And now that is a living Christ. Yeah. That's why we wore this t-shirt today.
Let's stand to our feet. The music team. Thank you. pray that you have received an understanding. That what we are communicating is not simply hot air. We are not looking to vainly puff you up. You know, there's some people like that. You are obsessed with quote unquote the knowledge of Christ, quote unquote. It has not, you have knowledge of scriptures, but those scriptures are not life to you. So we did not come to give you motivational talk, as Liz said. This is not fake it till you make it. Hallelujah. It is not be inspired before you expire. So you have to perspire, you know? Then you're writing all those things down. Nastik kwaloka wakotu. Be inspired before life expires. Get your Bible. Be inspired before life expires.